Good morning or good afternoon if you are following us from Asia or Australia. Welcome at the today webinar on tone manufacturing. My name is Lorenzo Miorelli and I'm part of Sacco Probiotic sales team. Let me introduce myself before. I have a master's degree in industrial biotechnology with academic experience in Italy and Denmark. I'm working in Sacco since the last 8 years, 5 of them spent in R&D department of the company developing strain and recipes, and 3 as technical sales and key account manager for several countries in Europe, North America, and Japan. Today, in the Sacco System webinar, we will discuss about tool manufacturing service and what are the different steps of process development, optimization, and upscaling to industrial scale before launching a probiotic on the market. Let me do a brief introduction of Sacco System before. Sacco System is proudly supporting food culture and life since 1872, when the first generation of our current director started the company near Como in Italy. Over the years, Sacco has formed into an international company with over 360 employees globally, helping clients develop brands and products within ingredients in more than 110 countries across the planet. This was possible thanks to the extraordinary synergy between 4 companies, Cadificio Clerici, Sacco, Centro Sperimentale del Latte, and Chemicalia. A unique and functional network maintains the characteristic and productive specialties of each entity. We are governed by our 7 core values of being a family company first, guided by our tradition and expertise. We invest 6% of our turnover in research and innovation using a multicultural approach. In fact, our R&D department hosts collaborators coming from 20 different countries. We have more than 50 collaborations with universities and research centers to ensure we bring our customers most up-to-date science, clinically proven, and newly discovered material around the world. We use creative intelligence and reliability to service our customers, ensuring we are flexible and can customize the offer to suit the brand owner needs. And as you're experiencing today, we live up to our knowledge sharing value by conducting webinars such as this. Sacco and CSL are 2 companies that offer a large range of innovative products. The core business includes probiotic cultures for supplement, pharma, and agro-veterinary industries, and starter cultures for food fermentation, mainly for dairy and dairy alternatives. Sacco is also selling instruments for the improvement of food. The sister company, Cadificio Clerici, has been an Italian leader in rennet production since 1872, and in 2006 acquired the Swedish company Chemicalia. Since then, both are offering a complete list of high-quality enzymes, additives, and coatings for the food market. Let's start today's webinar on tool manufacturing of probiotics. Help partners in transforming their idea and science in successful product on the market is one of the main activities of our company. Looking back to my personal experience, before as a pilot plant scientist, developing and optimizing the recipes of the strains, after supervising the strain development as technical sales manager, I learned a few tips and I would like to share them with you. Some could be obvious, but it's good to take them in mind when you start planning the studies on your next probiotic. First of all, I would say safety first. Probiotic properties are essential, but not enough. When you found a bug with excellent and promising beneficial effect, it's essential to check the safety of it before starting your work. The main lab analyses that allow you to avoid waste of time are species identification, Since there are several different regulations around the globe, I would say that looking at the European QPS list qualifying of safety, you will have already an indication if the species you have isolated can be reasonably safe and have a history of safety on human. Everyone is aware about the tremendous problem of multi-resistant pathogens. So the presence of transferable antibiotic-resistant genes, which comprises a theoretical risk of transfer to a less innocuous member of the gut microbial community, must also be considered. The first screening can be the phenotypical test performing a MIC or minimum inhibitory concentration test to confirm the non-transferability of the genes, if any, use a readily available and nowadays low-cost genomic sequencing technology to assure the absence of genes of concern is advisable. I strongly suggest you to perform a genome sequencing of your strain. Having it will allow you also to check the potential for pathogenicity or toxicogenicity. They may be assessed depending on the characteristic of the genus and species of your probiotic. Furthermore, the genome sequence could be used to understand better the mechanism of action of your probiotic or to check some further potential beneficial effect that could be hide in the genome. Daily dose and formulation. The optimal daily dose to show efficacy of your probiotic is probably one of the most difficult parts to finally define. In my opinion, the strategy, the higher, the better, is not beneficial. It makes you feel more comfortable moving to the human trial, but later on will generate you much more problems when you or your business partner have to develop the finished formula to launch on the market. You will save a lot of ages working on defining the minimum efficacy dose that you would think may work. If you are still uncertain about the minimum efficacy dose, my suggestion is to make a three-arm study using a placebo and two different probiotic concentrations. Could be this, the best option to move with. Delivery form is another important issue. The delivery of your form of your probiotic has to be well evaluated depending on the target group, be babies, kids, adults, elderly, for example, and also the tolerance of your strain to acid and bile salt. So if your probiotic, for example, is sensitive to the stomach acid, it would be preferable to use a gastro-resistant capsule, if the target group allows this. In the finished formula that you want to use in the trial or launch at the market, you have limited space. So remember to keep some space for the overage, able to guarantee the dose at the end of the shelf life. Having an indication about the potential use your probiotic can reach in a commercial batch, manufactured by your fermentation partner, will help you in having a more clear idea about the feasibility of the formulation. So I suggest also to consult your partner and try to understand what could be the potential yield of the species that you want to launch in the market. So let's go to how to select a partner for the fermentation. When you have to select your fermentation partner, you are bringing to them all the investment that you have done in the discovery of the potential of your probiotic. And their work will be a key part of your success on the business. So I don't see this as a relationship only as a normal step of the supply chain, but more like a strong collaboration between two companies. The quality and the yield that your fermentation partner will be able to give you as probiotic powder will be crucial for your success of your and your probiotic more greater will perform on the market more beneficial will be for your fermentation partner in terms of order. So this dualism and the sensitive nature of probiotics make a key requirement the selection of a partner with long history and know-how in the field. Not less, high reliability. It's good to discuss with your potential partner and check if they have previous experience with the species you would like to grow, so they can give you some indication about the expectation you can have with your strain. Working with valuable biological material is also important to check which quality system your future partner have in place, as, for example, FSSC 22000, GMP, SHACCP, and ISO. Depending on the market where you plan to launch your product, it may be needed also to have your probiotic recognized and certified by religious authorities as kosher and allowed. While if your aim is to manufacture a drug or a biotherapeutic product, you will need to find a company having the authorization in a production of active pharmaceutical ingredients, or API. During the selection of the partner, I would suggest you to check also the ability of offering a wider list of services. In this way, you will avoid having several interlocutors and delays, since the company producing the freeze-dried material will also perform required analysis internally, making the process time-saving and efficient. Furthermore, it's preferable to choose a partner that is able to follow your needs in the first step of development and sales, where lower volumes are needed, but also follow up when your growth became higher in volume. And higher volume will be required for the market. During the development phase, apart from the pilot plan work to set up and optimize the strain production process, it's good if your partner is able to offer some microbiological and molecular biology services. Speaking about SACO, we have dedicated the R&D department at your service to offer a wide range of tests you may need to better characterize your strain. Here you have some examples. So before starting the development, it's good to speak and clearly define with your partner the targets to achieve. An experienced tool manufacturer can give you advice about expectation on terms of yield, and you should evaluate what would be the optimal and minimum requirements for your probiotic products to guarantee the feasibility of the product. Since many ingredients may have a beneficial effect on the bacterial growth and survival, but on the other side, they could be unwanted for some specific market or for a clean label purpose, it's good to clarify all those details before. Once the targets are clear between the parties, is it possible to set a plan that takes in consideration the key milestone that will define the decision to proceed on the next step or reevaluate the strategy on an approximate and also set up an approximate timeline? Working with bacteria, the optimization could be a never-ending history. So it's good to have an equilibrium in the choice of, in terms of money invested, time, and results, which can be resumed as a PTT balance, where PTT stands for price, time, and target. Let's start the core of this webinar about how to develop a probiotic. Before sending the strain to your manufacturing partners, it's important to sign a material transfer agreement that will regulate the intention of the bulk sharing and protect both the parties. When the strain is sent to your partner company, is it important that they have a system to characterize and distinguish your probiotic from the others in the in their collection? And would be preferable if they have also a system to guarantee the identity, at least, of the species level of your bag. Taking as example what we do in SACCO when the strain is received, our microbiology lab, after the rate rotation in standard media, perform a characterization of it. The first step concerns all the analysis to guarantee the purity and species identity of the strain. In this way, we avoid to isolate the potential contaminant present in the vial that we receive. This is done by microbiology and molecular biology analysis. Plates with a specific differential media are used to evaluate the presence of different colony types in the sample received. If this happens, all the colonies are isolated and sent to the molecular lab for identification on species level using the 16S rRNA analysis. And if needed, PFGA electrophoresis to distinguish at strain level. Once the probiotic strain has been confirmed, it starts the characterization to generate an ID of it. The main analyses are microbiological, as colony description, color, size, border, any polymorphisms, for example. Microscopical, so like a description of the cell size, shape, if it forms any chains or clumps. And genetical, as I already say, using 16S and PFGA, but under request, we can also perform genome sequencing and bioinformatic analysis of the genome. Starting from the pure culture fully characterized, we create what we call a master seal that is stored in the cell bank. The master seal vials are rarely manipulated to produce to reduce the natural mutation event, since their role is to be the fingerprint and generator for what we call working seed vials that will be used for the pilot plant test and also production. Every batch of master and working seed are analyzed by our quality department to certify and approve the quality of the vials before storage. So the development and optimization of the production process is one of the key milestones for the success of the probiotic industrialization. Due to the complexity and sensitive nature of bacteria, an experienced R&D department may increase the potential of the strain in thermal field, ensuring the feasibility of your project and generating a consequential save of money. As Aristotle said, well begun is half done. So the first step in pilots should be testing different propagation media to find the best mix of ingredients and conditions to generate a rich and healthy starter culture, helping the transition from the working seed vials to the main fermentation vessel. Once the propagation media is optimized, a similar work is done for the fermentation media, testing different formulation in static condition. Usually we test different carbohydrates and nitrogen source with minerals based on our previous experience. From the data collected, the best media is selected and used to carry out a full process test in vessels that go from half a liter to 6 liter, equipped with a set of control instruments as temperature, steering, pH, and gas control that make them comparable to the industrial fermentation plant. Scientists monitoring the growth of bacteria under several aspects define the strain-specific kinetic growth and of the probiotic. The information are used to define when to stop the fermentation, I mean the highest yield of healthy cells. This is a critical step, since the moment to stop the fermentation may vary depending on strain, and more fermentation may be necessary to find the perfect balance between amounts of biomass, physiological wellness, and ability of the cells surviving at the downstream. The downstream is defined as the process to obtain a freeze-dried powder after the fermentation. The main step can be resumed in concentration, cryoprotected addition. It could be also a step of pelletization and freeze-drying. Every step is fundamental and has a lot of criticality. During concentration, the cells are separated since bacteria are denser than grow media. The quality of separation is affected by composition of the broth, temperature, or by some strain-specific metabolites, as for example, production of azopolysaccharides. R&D scientists work on defining the time and speed of the centrifuge to separate the cells from the rest of the media at the best. Once the bacterial biomass has been obtained, before moving to freeze drying, the addition of a solution called the cryoprotectant is needed. Supplementation of cryoprotectant confers an important protective effect to probiotic cells during freeze drying. A good composition of cryoprotectant can make a huge difference in the quality of the finished product. And speaking about probiotics, I would say that the term cryoprotectant is, in my opinion, limiting. In fact, those elements don't have only the ability to protect the cells from freezing damage, but they also permit the better survival of the freeze-dried powder during the storage. Our laboratory experience showed that also if there is a tendency of bacterial species in working better with the specific cryoprotectant, after the choice of the perfect mix is a strain specific manner. So an experienced lab can help in minimizing the number of cryoprotectant to test to contain the development investment and obtain optimal results. The concentrate can have two different processing steps. It can be directly freeze-dried or it can be pelletized. Pelletization is a process where beads of concentrate are dropped in liquid nitrogen to generate an instant freezing of the cells. From some strains, this process helps cell survival during the freeze-drying. But on the other side, it may generate a less fine powder during drying. Freeze-drying is considered still at the moment as the golden standard technique for the production of dried powder of probiotics. In the process, probiotics are exposed to damage from the process conditions such as very low freeze-drying temperature, and dehydration. Cells are first frozen to below the critical temperature of the formulation, and then dried by sublimation under high vacuum in two phases. The primary drying, during which unbound water is removed, and secondary drying, during which the bound water is removed. These stages can damage the constituent of the cell walls and lead the cell death. However, a fine optimization of the parameters in each step and the presence of cryoprotectant in dry medium increase the viability of the cells after drying. This is the last critical step in the manufacturing of probiotic powder. Crucial during the development phase is also monitoring the viability and the quality of the product in every main step to define a critical point and better evaluate where the focus in where to focus in the optimization of the process. Before moving to a full-scale commercial batch, I would recommend to confirm the robustness and feasibility of the best recipe developed in the semi-industrial scale. This step is usually performed in fermenters that can vary between, say, 50 and 200 liters, connected with centrifuge using a comparable technology of the one used in the manufacturing site. The semi-industrial scale due to the technological similarity with the production, is able to predict in a more accurate way how the probiotic will be in the industrial fermenter. Furthermore, it can generate enough material to permit different tests, as could be stability, finished product test, or in vitro or in vivo trials. Okay, let's go to the real production when we will scale up. When the development journey is finally finished, we are ready to replicate what we saw in the previous slide, but just on the larger volumes. When the process transfer is moved from pilot to production, the internal team is working to adapt it on a new site and make it robust and standardized. In this way, we can limit at the minimum the natural heat fluctuation from batch to batch. In this slide, I want just to give you an idea about the timeline of a standard production process that we make every day in our facility. Starting from the vial stored in our cell bank, it takes approximately 3 days to obtain enough viable material to use as inoculant for the main fermenter. In our facility, we have several fermenter sites we may use to offer a flexible services covering the needs of our clients in terms of volume. The main fermentation time can vary depending on the species, but it can be resumed in approximately 1 day. Another way is necessary to concentrate the biomass, add the cryo protectant, and feed the freeze dryer to start the drying process. The freeze drying process takes approximately 3 days. After that, there is something that was less discussed in the previous slide, that is the grinding, since from the freeze dryer, normally you have what we call a biscuit, so a big piece of freeze dried material that has to be grinded or milled in a specific clean room and packed to be stored in the cold room. Depending from the volumes, but the process takes, let's say, approximately half a day, 1 day. A sample of this material is sent to our quality control laboratory that to perform a complete microbiological analysis takes up to 10 days, checking not only the viability and the moisture inside the material, but also pathogens and the purity of the product. The fourth step is needed if standardization of the material is required or a blending without a probiotic is requested from the client. So another day is needed for blending and packaging, and 10 days for the final quality control analysis. So, as you may easily calculate, a total process can take from 19 to 30 days without any interruption between the different steps. I would say that luckily is shorter than having a good whiskey, but still consistent time considering the request from the market. Moreover, in this slide, the process described doesn't take into account all the cleaning process that has to be performed with the highest standard to reduce the potential contamination between one batch and the next one. So as you may understand, it's quite a long process, the production, the development, and the production. I hope that my presentation was useful to understand a little bit better about how to select and develop your probiotic from moving from laboratory to commercial scale, and you got a more clear idea about what is important to look for. Let me just wrap up what I think are the most important things. Expertise, look for companies that have a long history in the field. Reliability, this is really fundamental. The experience of a good for a good journey in your product development, build up partnership with a company, and find people that you trust. This is really essential. Services. Having a single interlocutor, in my opinion, will help you on focus on your business. And quality, speaking about probiotics, quality has to be always a priority. Also, flexibility is very important, since your probiotic is unique and your business will not be static. So a flexible and tailor-made service will help you in succeed. And support, as a last, since a partner with a long expertise and also an extended network can support you and your product in moving from laboratory to market. I would say not only for the production, development and production of the strains, but I would suggest you to take the time to discuss and find a solution to make your partnership stronger, also if you need help to move in other markets or to develop your business. I want to thank you for your attention, and I will leave now a little time for making some questions. Some I already received. You have a dedicated space on to send the questions. So the first one is how much percent inoculum required to transfer in large scale fermenter, and what cryoprotectant use? This is a very good question. For the inoculum, it's strain specific. It could be approximately from 1 to 5%. But normally, when we make the development, we make some small tests to define what could be the best inoculum percentage. About the cryoprotectant, this is also really strain specific, and we develop several cryoprotectant during the last 70 years, 80 years of work in fermenting. But of course, I cannot share this information, and I have no possibility to specify the cryoprotectant to use. Okay, I have a second question that is speaking about quality certification. What would be the best between ISO, GMP, and FSSC? I'm not a regulatory person, but I can just say, but out of my knowledge, that probably FSSC 22000 will be the best choice, since is globally recognized as the new food safety standard. And should incorporate all the elements of a GMP and HACCP, probably also big part of ISO 9001. So my suggestion would be to go for or looking for an FSSC 22000 certified company. I have another question that say, is it possible to have probiotics that are free of any allergen and suitable for vegetarian? Yes, of course. Based on what we do in our in SACCO and CSL, most of our probiotic lines are free of any allergen following the EU regulation, So the main ones, like soy, nuts, milk, gluten, sesame, shellfish, and lupin, and whatever. And also by policy, we don't use any animal ingredients apart for some dairy derivatives that are mainly used for in the facility that is producing the starter cultures for the dairy market. I have another question. Which certification do you have for production, and specifically GMP Pharma? We have for both the company that are manufacturing probiotics, so Sacco and CSL, FSSC 22000 for the supplement market and food market, while we have also a GMP pharma certification for both the company that we are using just for the toll manufacturing. So we can toll manufacture and toll manufacture biotherapeutics or API. Okay, I think that the time we are already late with the time, unfortunately, but I will try to answer all the remaining question by mail directly. I remember you that you can rewatch all the previous webinar and the one of today on the webinar.sacosystem.com, or you can find also a link on our main website, sacosystem.com. If you have any other requests or you need more information, you can send a mail to webinar@sacosystem.com or contact directly me at l.miorelli@sacosrl.it. Thank you for watching. I hope you enjoy the webinar. Bye.